Now, before I talk about this week's Raw, surely at least some of you would like to know my thoughts about last week's show since I didn't do a review. Well, I'll go ahead and tell you them really quickly. I thought last week's Raw was good, bordering on pretty good, but most certainly not great. I think, again, this show was an example of how our standards have lowered as wrestling fans. We're passing off good as great, and I assure you there is a big difference. I most certainly don't think this lived up to the standards of post-WrestleMania Raws of, let's say, post 27, 28, and 29. I think this fell a little bit more in line with the Raw we got after WrestleMania 30, which again was good, pretty good, better than this year's post-WrestleMania Raw, in my opinion. You know, good show, you know, some debuts, some nice things that happened, some nice shock value, but I thought the show kind of tailed off towards the end and really had a kind of anticlimactic finish with the main event. It was just kind of a thud, frankly. I mean, and, you know, that should be the culmination. That should be something big happens. And of all the places where nothing big happened, it was in that main event. You got some good match quality on the show. Like I said, again, some nice debuts for Lucha Dragons and Neville, what have you. A good show. I'm not going to sit here and spend a lot of time knocking it. That's part of the reason why I didn't do a review of it last week, because I get tired of knocking it all the time, believe it or not. So I'll just say, it was a good show. I don't think it was good as the post WrestleMania 27 Raw or the 28 Raw or the 29 Raw. I think it was even a little bit behind the 30 Raw. It started to go down just a little bit. If I got more shows like this more weeks, I'd be a lot happier as a WWE fan. Let's put it that way. That's pretty much my thoughts on last week's show. Now let's talk about this week's Raw. I most certainly won't talk about everything that happened on this week's Raw because, frankly, I just don't think there's a whole lot to talk about. I'll talk about the things that I want to talk about, that I have interest in talking about, and the rest of it I'm just not going to. Now, the first thing that really stands out to me was early on in this show, they were presenting it as if they were trying to create an environment where Raw was a little bit more unpredictable and wasn't going to be quite as static or predictable as it usually is. And it seemed like at the beginning they were kind of trying to gravitate towards that. But at the end of the day, it just ends up being pretty much the same show. It's the same format. You can usually predict a lot of times what's going to happen and what 15-minute block of segment on that particular show, and a lot of times who's actually going to be featured in what segment. You know, it's called Raw, and yet this show feels like anything other than Raw. I wish the WWE would make the show actually feel more Raw and feel more unpredictable, because they've gotten so pathetically predictable in their patterns of presentation for Raw each week that it really hinders my viewing experience. Now, one of the big talking points coming out of last week's show, ironically enough for fans, was the commentary of Byron Saxton. Once Cole and Booker and JBL were taken care of and disposed of by Brock Lesnar, they bring out Byron Saxton, and then later on they send out Jerry Lawler. And a lot of the thought was that Byron Saxton was bad, he was brutally bad, he was terrible on commentary. And look, I'll admit, he wasn't very good. And he probably isn't quite ready for prime time. I've been watching SmackDown, so I don't know how he does on SmackDown, but if this is any indication last week of what he does on SmackDown, then that's not very good. However, with that said, let's keep this in mind. The commentary on this show has been terrible for years now. Years. And for somebody like, let's say, Vince, who reportedly is so upset about Saxton and his commentary that he only had to try and send Jerry Lawler out to save it, but he refused to speak to Saxton after the show. Have you listened to your commentators in recent years? They don't call the action. They don't tell good stories. They're caught up in stupid bad jokes that nobody finds funny. They talk about all types of random shit other than what the fuck they need to. They don't entertain. They don't capture the action. They don't accentuate the story that is attempting to be presented. They're a reflection of the product. It's not good. The commentary isn't good. And you can talk about Michael Cole all you want, but he's been doing it for over a decade and a half, and he's not that particularly good either. So I don't see how Byron Saxton was so much worse. And then we're talking about Jerry Lawler. When was the last time Jerry Lawler pretended to be a good commentator? What, 2007, 2008? He's been bad for years. All these people shitting all over Byron Saxton for his commentary. Frankly, he didn't do much worse. I thought he did better this week. A little bit. I mean, still wasn't very good. But then again, nobody's fucking good at it. And if some of you are going to sit there and say, well, then put Renee Young in that spot. Well, she most certainly isn't ready. She's awkward and bad half the time on the fucking panels on the network. That's the truth. Yes, the commentary is bad, but it's not like it got a whole lot worse with Byron Saxton. Let's be serious here. One of the real notable things for me with this week's show was who wasn't there. Now, I understand that maybe some of these guys get a little bit of a break post-WrestleMania. I don't fucking know. But here you are, 8 days after WrestleMania. There's no IC champion in Daniel Bryan. There's no Dolph Ziggler. There's no Dean Ambrose. There's no Triple H. There's no Stephanie. There's no Rusev. Not to mention other key figures that were featured at WrestleMania, like the usual suspects like the Taker, the Sting, and the Lesnar, who you wouldn't expect to be there any damn ways. But some of these guys that you would expect to be there, you know, they weren't there at all in any way, shape, or form. You can't shoot some type of pre-recorded video package. You can't do some type of anything with them. No Daniel Bryan, no Dolph Ziggler, no Dean Ambrose, no Triple H or Stephanie, no Rusev. I mean, these are people that were featured at WrestleMania. These are people that get a reaction out of the fans, and they weren't there. And you noticed it this week. It showed, and it definitely contributed to the poor show that I thought we ultimately got. Now, many of you were excited, at least somewhat, by the possibility of John Cena becoming the United States champion because you believed, if nothing else, John Cena would be the type of performer that would elevate the profile of the mid-card title that you love so near and dear to your heart. And I understand that because I am somebody that values those mid-card titles tremendously. I think they're criminally underutilized by the WWE, and that's a shame. And it's a reflection of the overall problems with their product, and I think that lack of proper utilization of those mid-card titles is a major hindrance to the growth of the product, the development of stars, what have you. So I understand where a lot of you might be excited about this John Cena open challenge every week, where he's calling out somebody. A lot of you, I think, frankly, will be fooled into thinking this is something really good because the matches aren't going to suck. You know, they're not going to sit there and send out scrubs to wrestle John Cena. They sent out Dean Ambrose last week. This week they sent out Cody Rhodes, Stardust. I mean, these aren't guys that Cena's going to have a bad match with. These are guys that Cena's going to have a good match with. So for some of you who claim that you value something other than just the in-ring action, even though all you ever talk about is just the in-ring action, this is going to fool some of you into thinking this helps elevate the profile of the belt, that this will make Cena a good U.S. champion, and this will be wonderful in this. But unfortunately, in a lot of ways, it's just more of the same with Cena facing somebody, them trying to fool us for 10 or 15 minutes, although the whole damn time we know good and well Cena's winning. He's going to win every time. He's going to beat everybody. And it's more of the same, too, besides just that, with the fact that it's just matches. There's no real story here to this open challenge. I mean, he supposedly got a rematch with Rusev as Extreme Rules, yet Rusev is nowhere to be fucking found on this week's show. And he's just calling out people for matches where he's ultimately going over. This isn't exactly something strikingly, awesomely different with the U.S. title, because so often with these mid-card titles in recent years, the U.S., the IC title, the tag titles, it's just match, 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 and that's supposed to be a story, and that's not a story at all. And with Cena carrying the title, right now with this open challenge, to me, it's more of the same. And it only worsens the situation in terms of the lack of potential challengers that could be taken seriously going after Cena and that belt. And that's part of the problem with Cena having that U.S. title, is because you have few challengers to begin with. Now you're feeding up any potential challengers on a silver platter to him every week in this open challenge. Now once he dispatches of Rusev in short order at Extreme Rules, where the hell do you go? Bray Wyatt? How'd that work out for him last year?
Bray Wyatt.
The face of fear. Speaking of Bray Wyatt, why the hell should anybody take him seriously now? It seems like every time he's put into a big program against somebody that really matters, he freaking loses. The face of fear, the only thing he should be the face of fear of is the face of fear of losing, because when it comes to the big one, he can't get it done. My favorite segment of the show this week was a match, believe it or not. It was Neville versus Seth Rollins. I love so many different pieces of this and so many different components of this. Now, the first thing I will say from Neville's standpoint, I like the fact that they're not treating him like a total joke. I like the fact that they're at least trying, at least initially, to take him somewhat seriously. Obviously, the crowd is really behind him because many of them recognize him from his time in NXT. Not sure why they dropped Adrian out of the Adrian Neville name. I don't understand where Neville makes sense as a one-word name. You know what? You get what I'm saying here. But I like the thought of the young upstart taking on the new champion. And this worked for me for so many different levels. This wasn't a star-spangled, awesome, five-star classic type of match. know, but it was a good, solid match that helped establish Neville a little bit while still making sure that Seth Rollins went over. Now, I saw somebody like Jim Ross tweet about the fact that he thought Neville should have went over here. Jim Ross tweeted this horse shit. And I'm sure there are other people that agreed with him. You just had Seth Rollins, mind you, cash in at WrestleMania. So he didn't even win the belt in a full match. This is a guy that so often has to sit there and get help in order to win matches, whether it be against opponents of similar abilities or lower abilities or superior abilities. It doesn't matter. And even here, you've got J&J Security running distractions several times throughout the different freaking moments of the match. And you're going to put Neville over the guy that just won your belt at freaking WrestleMania non-title match? That's dumb ass bullshit. Part of the whole appeal here is the fact that Neville showed himself well, but ultimately came up short. This is an example of where a loss elevates somebody, similar to what happened in 2002 when John Cena debuted on SmackDown against Kurt Angle. He came out aggressive. He showed something. Angle went over. Everybody is better off for it, and everybody wins with the segment. If you have Neville go over here, it backfires in so many different levels. Now you've got people thinking, oh my God, Neville could be the freaking next champion when he's clearly not ready for that spot. Now you're sitting there and diminishing Seth Rollins, who already has a bit of a credibility issue when it comes to winning matches straight up clean. Now he's losing to the guy that 8 days ago wasn't even on the main WWE roster. This is the type of stupid shit that people involved with the wrestling business say from time to time that absolutely astound me. Again, though, with that said, I love so many things about this. I thought this was a huge spotlight for Neville, and I thought he showed himself really well. Rollins really showing the type of quality heel champion that he can be. I hope this isn't the last time we'll get a segment like this. My one hope, though, for this is that they don't just kind of bury this in the first hour. This should have been a featured segment. This should have been the 1 hour or 2 hour main event. To sit there and put it in that 8:30 to 8:45 time block, I thought was, frankly, a bit of a mistake. Well, they're showing different video packages throughout the night, like the confrontation between The Rock and Ronda Rousey with Stephanie and Triple H. They're showing what happens with Brock Lesnar. And my whole problem with this is the fact that it reminds you of who's not there. It reminds you of what's not going on Raw. Now, I get you have to tie into what happened. You're trying to make these things a big deal. And I get that. In the long term, that makes sense. But in the short term, to me, if anything, it emphasizes why you don't really need to necessarily watch Raw, because the biggest and best moments are going to happen at the bigger shows like the pay-per-views. And again, you're trying to tie that into the network and get people to subscribe. I get that. I applaud you for that. That's the right thing to do in a way. But it can also backfire, too, because now I'm sitting there and saying, shit, Rock was there. He ain't going to be here. Ronda Rousey was there. She's most certainly not going to be here. Lesnar's not here. Hell, Triple H and Stephanie weren't on this week's show. You know, you show other packages like Sting and Taker and so on and so forth, and you're just reminding us of maybe why we shouldn't be watching, why we don't need to watch, because so many of these biggest stars, so many of these top names aren't freaking there. I seriously would like to know who came up with the wise-ass idea of putting The Miz versus Mizdow as a match on this show, like actually having a full match on this show and saving it to almost the end of the freaking night. Why? Why did this need to happen? Why did it need to happen here? You have a pay-per-view event coming up. Why not save that match for that pay-per-view? I understand you're probably going to have this match again at the pay-per-view, but that's part of the whole point. You've kind of already had the match. Yeah, you could throw in a stipulation, what have you, but you've already had the freaking match. Why would you give this shit away if you're expecting people to fucking pay for it? And then the main event was this triple threat number one contenders match with Randy Orton and Ryback and Roman Reigns. I liked how they were interviewing Ryback and Randy Orton, you know, trying to hype this up and try to make this be a big thing. Part of what I don't understand about the whole thing, going back to the opening segment of the night when Kane's talking about what's best for business, you know, Orton's the only one with a contractual rematch guaranteed. So shouldn't he, as a result, automatically get that title shot? Or if you're going to sit there and go with this, is that you got three potential options, why wouldn't you choose jabronis? Frankly, I'm sorry, jabronis, but people like you know, a freaking Dolph Ziggler and R-Truth, you know, yeah, for hell, frankly, you know, somebody like a Dean Ambrose who can't seem to win anything at this point in time. Why would you sit there and serve up people like Orton and Ryback and Roman Reigns? That doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense. And if you're going to do this, and you're going to throw those three out there, why not at least make what part of the story throughout the entire night that you beat the shit out of each one of these guys in their match and then beat the shit out of them again in the main event where there's not a clear and decisive finish, a clear and decisive winner? Instead, you have Kane hit Randy Orton with the chair, but then it's Ryback going over Luke Harper, it's Roman Reigns going over Big Show. It just didn't make a whole lot of sense to me. I thought the WWE really dropped the ball in their storytelling here because there frankly wasn't much of a story told. Also, what I don't understand is when we get to the whole thing throughout the night of Kane talking about what's best for business as director of operations and Seth Rollins and all of this, you know, Rollins defending the title was best for business, but Brock Lesnar defending it isn't. Does that make any sense to anybody? No, it doesn't. It's wrestling, I guess. Sports entertainment, excuse me. It's not supposed to fucking make sense. And while the WWE tried to make this a big match, and I applaud them for doing that, and they featured this where they needed to in the main event, it just didn't really feel like a big match. And the ending was kind of a thud. And did anybody think that anybody other than Randy Orton was going over anyways? It's just kind of one of these things, just because you can do it doesn't mean you should do it. It felt like, you know, whereas the WWE used to way back when create episodic television where not only could they carry a story over a period of time, most importantly of all, they would make a theme or a story throughout a particular night. I didn't really get what the theme of this night was here. I don't really get what the story they were trying to tell was here. It almost seemed like they wasted 3 hours of our time to get to where everybody knew they were already going, and frankly, it was the only option they really had, which was Randy Orton's going to face Seth Rollins at Extreme Rules. We could have just gotten this shit out of the way in the opening segment and been done with it. Why did we need 3 hours to get to this point when everybody knew we were freaking getting there? Like I said, it would have been more unpredictable. It would have been better, frankly, especially if you're trying to tease heat between Rollins and Kane, if you sit there and have all three of those guys get beat up throughout the night and then all three of them get beat down by, let's say, Rollins and Big Show and J&J Security in the main event, and then Kane gets pissed off because he feels like somebody's trying to usurp his authority and he makes it a fatal four-way match at Extreme Rules. I'm just saying. It just felt like this show was largely a waste of time. And I think as the night went along and it was reflecting in hour three of the ratings and the big drop-off they had, the show tailed off as it went along. It got worse, and it didn't get better, and it was largely a thud, which is, frankly, what I've come to expect out of Raw most weeks with the WWE.